on the air on 6444. Tell them I...
By a woman gynec.
Carefree OB, a woman's idea. Her mod...
...side economically. It runs on kerosene. Just 6.4 liters of fuel give you up to 36 hours of warmth. It's 99.9% fuel efficient, so there's no smoke, no odor, just heat. It's safety tested, easy to operate. There's a whole range of heaters to provide you with a balmy winter inside. Efficient, economical Kerosun portable heaters, because you don't have money to burn.
Silkiest does it again.
The new self-adjusting shampoo that cleans
hard where your hair is oily,
conditions where it's dry.
The computer shows dark where Kay's hair is too oily,
yet it's dry here.
Silkiest cleans the roots like gangbusters.
But watch, conditioners protect the ends.
The science of super cleaning your hair
without hurting it.
Silkiest wipes the greasiest city grime away, but
conditions wherever it's dry.
Silkiest
self-adjusting shampoo
beats the grease
without beating the ends.
Coming up next, Webster.
Good morning. Tragedy struck shortly after midnight last night on the road to Whistler once again. It would seem that two bridges are out, the road bridge at M Creek and a rail bridge at Yahoo Creek, just between Brunswick Beach and Lions Bay. The count so far appears to be six dead. Five bodies may already have been recovered. Five people have been injured, one in hospital in Squamish in satisfactory condition, one in hospital in Lionsgate, North Vancouver, and three people treated and released. It was, by all accounts, a massive mudslide that built up on the side of the hill and came tumbling down, taking, without any warning at all, taking out a major road bridge, as a result of which cars plowed straight into the vast area of mud and rock which had swamped the highway and the railway lines. Now, on the helicopter, on a BC television helicopter above the scene now is Steve Wright of Horizon Helicopter. Steve, what can you see?
Well, Jack, we're just hovering off to the south side of the washout at this time, Jack. It isn't seen at all. Starting at the water, it's completely brown from the amount of the mud that's washed down into it. There is a part of a house visible right on the shoreline. Badly damaged car is on its side right along beside the house. The damage is just, it's hard to put into words, Jack. The railway is completely wiped out. There's about 100 feet of the road bridge that is wiped completely out. We have extensive crews, backhoes, high hoes, and here right now. And it's devastating.
Tell me, are they using a big drag line to try and get a car out of the mud and rock right now, Steve?
That's negative, Jack. They just seem to be concentrating in the area around the road. They see some engineers down there looking at the washout.
Okay, Steve Wright of Horizon Helicopters. You can
perhaps concerned that some more will wash away.
Okay.
The water's rushing quite rapidly.
Fine, Steve. You carry on with your coverage with our cameraman, and I'll go now. Thanks, Steve. I'll go now to Bob Ireland, our reporter on the spot, on the ground near the devastation at Lions Bay. Bob, are you there?
Yes, Jack.
What's the score?
The situation is pretty grim, Jack. There is about a 60-foot drop where the road once was, as the center span of the bridge has been washed out. Down below, there is thick, oozing mud. I have already, just standing on the banks of the stream, been bespattered with mud. The police dogs, the police, and the rescue workers who are working directly at the scene are covered literally from head to toe with mud. There are bits of cars that have been shattered, just like pieces of particle board.
Okay, Bob, as I understand it, three vehicles went through. I don't know if they all came from the same site, but one was a van. And there were five people in the van, I believe, in which four people died and one woman survived miraculously. Is that the count you get on that one vehicle?
So I understand. Now, at the present time that Steve probably can't see, there is a drag line working to unearth another car that is just down below the bridge.
And then one person was found dead in another car.
Yes.
So that means five confirmed dead, one or more possibly, and five survivors as of this moment.
Yes. My understanding is that there may be six dead, Jack.
Maybe six dead. It's always confusing. Who is in charge?
The highways department says that it's going to take a few days. They're going to put a 300-foot Bailey Bridge over the road.
Uh-huh.
Their explanation for the washout is that apparently a log jam must have built up. There is a small cataract just above where the bridge is located. And the department says that these streams in this area are usually rigorously checked to ensure that things like this don't happen.
But
they can't give any explanation for how this one came down.
Bob, we'll see your coverage on the noon news and on the nighttime news. And thanks very much. If anything else startling happens, will you call me during the program?
Yes, I will, Jeff.
Much obliged. Here is Brian Coxford, who's been talking to a survivor this morning. Brian, what can you tell me?
The survivor that we talked to, Jack, is a fellow by the name of Joe Chisholm, a 21-year-old man who's in the publishing business from Calgary. He was in the front line just when it happened. Less than 20 feet in front of him, the bridge just gave way, and he described it as it was just like a giant pie crust, mud and water, and all of a sudden it was gone. And he was going down with it. The drop about 50 to 100 feet, and there was Joe in the car and four other people. A girl beside him who had just hired on with his publishing company that very day.
He was in the car that went over.
He was the first car to go over. And the girl beside him who had just hired on with his company that day was one of the people that was killed. The other three people in the car managed to get out, and he describes it as an utter miracle that anybody walked away from it. It was about a 75 to 100-foot drop. The car turned over, and they were deep in mud, windows rolled up, and it was just miraculous. He said his major concern was for the others in the car, but he never thought he would live through it.
Was he badly injured?
He managed to get out with just a broken nose and body laceration, so he's very fortunate.
Brian, just to sum up there, it was just between Brunswick Beach and Lions Bay, at least one major bridge out, perhaps the railway bridge in Yahoo Creek also out. It looks like six dead, a number of bodies recovered, and you've spoken to one of the survivors who lived through miraculously.
Thanks, yes, Joe. Joe described it this way, Jack. His car was coming up the road, heading south, and there was a car behind him. As the bridge went out 20 feet in front of him, both cars went down. A couple of other cars were heading north. One in front managed to stop right on the edge, but the car behind it swerved, went around that car, and went down. And it was raining heavily. It was a bitter night out there, and it was just black and miserable.
Brian Coxford of BCTV News Hour, thanks very much. We'll see your coverage perhaps on this program, certainly on the noon and on tonight. Thanks, Brian.
Thanks, Jack.
Much obliged. These events overtake one, of course. There's been lots of trouble on that highway for lots of reasons, but one of the principal reasons has been a heavy rainfall, I suppose. This is an area where the rail line runs below the highway. Now, Hugh, how about Armstrong of BC Rail? Is he around? Perhaps Hugh can tell me what the actual score on the railway is, what's out and what's not out. But you know the score as it is at the moment. It looks like there was one very bad event. Well, three cars over at least, one a van in which four of the five people seem to have died, and another car where a woman was found dead in the car. Now, is Hugh there? What line's he on? Hugh Armstrong of BC Rail.
Hello.
Can you tell me what happened to the railroad last night?
Well, it got washed out, Jack. There's two bridges down there on Yahoo Creek. One of the bridges we know is gone. It's a bridge that contains a siding of the railway.
Right.
The main track, we haven't been able to establish whether that part of the track is still going across the bridge because the RCMP will not let us in close enough to see. There's a power line down. It's quite dangerous, so we're trying to establish at the present time whether that bridge is still intact. It's covered with mud.
Has this
it may be that we can get through there later today. We won't know that for another couple of hours.
As far as the rail line concerned, which seems comparatively unimportant at the moment, you don't know whether the main rail bridge can be cleared or if it will, like the road bridge, have to be rebuilt.
Yeah, at the present time, we haven't been right into that bridge, which is the main track bridge. That's correct. If we can get through there, we'll be running again quite soon, and then we can start carrying equipment back and forth and making a rail link possible with the highway out, you see.
Hugh, I'll keep in touch with you.
Thank you.
My thanks to Hugh Armstrong of BC Rail. Well, that's our coverage as of this moment. We'll have more coverage on the program later, including videotape coverage of last night's disaster just between Lionsgate and Brunswick Beach. I'll be back after the break. We shall continue with bulletins on the Lions Bay Brunswick Beach disaster as they become available this morning, and we shall give you coverage of the from the scene before the program ends today at 10:30. There'll be full coverage on the noon news hour, of course, and on BC TV News tonight. However, one must get back to one's normal order of business. And I have known DERA, the Downtown Eastside Residents Association, low these many years. I sometimes get on very well with them, and I sometimes don't. With me this morning is Libby Davies.
Morning.
Morning, Libby. And Jim Green.
Good morning, Jack.
We haven't met before, have we?
That's correct.
Seeing I'm a bit hyper this morning because, you know, covering the accident and everybody rushing around, let me put it to you bluntly, Libby. You have a plan starting today, do you not, whereby you hope to grind to a halt much of the procedures of the Human Resources Department to make your political point. Is that correct?
Well, it's not to make a political point. It's to try and help as many individuals who are on gain who have been affected by a new policy that is reclassifying people to employable. And what DERA is doing with the Welfare Rights Coalition is that as people pick up their checks today at the various welfare offices, we are going to be outside the welfare offices in the lineups, and we're going to be helping people fill out appeals. Now, under the GAIN Act, somebody can appeal if they've had a reduction in their allowance. And because the new policy means that people will be getting up to 27% less money, we're going to be helping them appeal that so that while the appeal is going through, they have to be kept on at the same rate that they were before.
Now, don't let me misquote you. What you're going to do is that if there are a number of adjustments under Human Resources' new policy of making certain qualifications apply each month for the eligibility, correct? You are going to make quite sure that you put in an appeal on their behalf, if you can talk them into it, so that the amounts of money they receive cannot be changed.
Okay.
Is that right?
That's correct.
Now, what you want to, by use of administrative log jams, you want to freeze the system and embarrass the government.
Well, I don't know whether it will freeze the system. I hope so, because the point is to try and keep people at the rate that they were before, which was totally inadequate anyway. We don't have to talk people into it.
Yeah.
People are coming to the DERA office in droves. We've been getting phone calls every day from out through the whole Lower Mainland of people who want to find out what they can do, how they can appeal. So we're not soliciting appeals. It's coming to us.
Oh, you are, because you're sending people to the offices today to say, hey, have you been told? What can they be told at the worst today? You said 27% cut. What you mean, in fact, is a dollar cut of how many dollars on what classifications?
Well, if a person has been reclassified to employable, if they're a single person, they'll get $55 a month less. If it's a single parent with one child, they also get $55 a month less. Or if it's a family, they'll get $35 a month less.
On the requalification status, if they don't requalify under the ministry's incentive program.
As long as they have been reclassified, they will get the cutback. And then, if you're a single person, you'll have to reapply every month. That means every month you will have to go back to the welfare office, fill out another form to reapply for welfare. If you're a family, you'll have to do it every 4 months.
That's right. Now, about 3 times a year, if you're a single parent, you'll have to requalify.
Three times four is 12. Yeah, yeah, that's correct.
Every fourth month.
That's correct.
Now, surely, I'm not going to suggest it's all kind of fraud or rip-off in welfare. One can give all kinds of hyperbole in that. But surely nobody nowadays regards a single mother as the type of person she was in the 50s. She's a much better educated person nowadays. She's got a much better standard, hasn't she? And some of my women friends say that you people downgrade the abilities of single parents who want to work.
That's incorrect. We don't downgrade anyone's abilities. We say that people that are not able to work, where there's not child care available, where there aren't jobs that people can go into, that those people should not be forced into the job market. And we don't believe that by cutting people's money by $55 a month from their children is helping a person get a job.
If they're cut,
but we understand that they are to be cut. People are already being cut.
The problem is...
Why is today important?
Because today is the first, well, today is check day. People are picking up their November checks, right? And it's November the 1st, or when they get their November check, that the new policy comes into effect. But listen, the problem with this policy is that it's a blanket policy. You see, the welfare system as it is, they already, social workers are trained to find out when people are able to go to work. They put them into various training programs. We hire people in very highly paid jobs to do that. That's what they're trained to do. But what the minister has done is come out with a totally blanket policy. And it ends up being a very punitive thing, you see. It's not an incentive to go to work. It's a punishment.
You've got no complaints, I presume, even in DERA, to asking single parents to make a serious effort to find a job.
I think single parents have always been making a serious effort to find a job.
As a matter of fact, the statistics shown to by human resources shows that single parents do not badly in getting jobs under the present system.
Hey, you know what? By Mrs. McCarthy's own statistics, she says that 63% of people who come on income assistance go off after 4 months. That means they find jobs on their own. Another 40% go off in 1 month.
That's
okay?
Right. These
so
are
that means
figures.
That the
That's
remaining
right.
people are people who are genuinely in need, the people who for whatever particular circumstance are not able to go out and find work. They may be handicapped, they may be 60 years old, they may have children, whatever. So, I mean, by her own admission, the amount of time that people spend on assistance is very minimal, right? People find jobs on their own.
Well, let's forget the single parents. Let's look at the single able-bodied unemployed. Is it not a good thing to have a little bit of incentive by saying, hey, you got to show you're making serious effort to find employment. You've got to reapply to show us you're making a serious effort, and you've got to take advantage of what we say are rehabilitation opportunities available for you. Is there anything wrong with
There's
that?
There's nothing wrong with that, but that's not what's happening exactly.
They already have that.
If you
come in as a single person, a young man, an able-bodied man, you're not given assistance. You're given food vouchers, you're put in a hostel, you're not given assistance.
In some circumstances. It depends on whether or not you're a transient.
Very few. We're talking about the majority.
If you're a single able-bodied, unemployed, non-transient, you get assistance, don't you?
You get assistance, but this policy is mainly aimed at people that are in their 50s, Jack. Single older men who cannot find work. That's who it's going to affect the most. In the downtown east side, it's going to affect probably 3,500, we presume. We don't know exactly.
3,500?
That's right. That's what we're
told.
That's
just in the downtown core where DERA operates.
And what are the jobs that are available to people that haven't worked in 15 years, that are elderly people?
Because one of the problems is that you can still make more on welfare, and I don't say this unkindly, than you can working in a cafeteria at $3.50 an hour, right?
You can't make more, but at least you don't have to go out and put all the expenses you would have for clothes and transportation and everything
medical.
Else.
That's another thing. The people who have been reclassified to employable, even though they may still be on assistance from month to month, they lose all of their medical benefits. Now, for a mother with children, that's a very serious problem. No medical.
Right. As of this moment, how many appeals against the beginning of the month have you managed to launch?
I would say roughly 700.
700.
We have the list right here, the ones that at least have gone through
are these,
our office.
Do they willingly sign these things, or do you just dragoon them in and sign them?
We don't pressure anybody. We give people information. We say this is what your rights are under the GAIN Act. If you wish to appeal, DERA will assist you.
So even if some of these people should be under the incentive program or be, you know.
Just a moment, Jack. The incentive program has a long waiting list. People can't get on the incentive program. That's
but
the problem.
Anyway, here you tell me proudly that 700 people whose money they cannot cut under the new government scheme. Is that
That's
right?
That's correct.
How long does an appeal take to go through?
It should take about 2 months.
2 months. And you should have it up to how many? 3,500 in no time flat?
Should do.
Well, we're trying to.
What are you laughing about?
Well, you know, you're just tossing out numbers. I mean,
you tossed out the number, 3,500. No.
Well, no, Jack, that's look. How many people will be affected. I don't know whether we'll get in 3,500 appeals.
But
we only have a few volunteers who are doing it, but we'll try our best anyway to help as many people.
And the point is, when you're on very low income and someone's taking $55 out of your pocket, you don't have to go and pressure that person to do anything.
I find it very difficult to argue that anybody is overpaid on welfare, I'll tell you. And if people are losing money on welfare now, one has great sympathy with them.
Especially I'm just wondering
if there, if there is not some justification. It's not Gracie McCarthy, it's human resources. Barrett would probably be doing the same thing, wouldn't he?
I don't know. I don't think so.
$800 million. How much is it for administration? $80 million for social welfare administration.
How much is it for BC Place?
As of this moment, it's about $60 million with a predicated borrowing of anything up to $500, $600, $700, $800, $900, $1 billion.
Right.
Look at the jobs it will give.
It'll give a lot of jobs, but none of the people that we're talking about.
You
here.
Don't hear the unions complaining about BC Place, do you?
Well, we don't hear the unions complaining about it, but we're talking about people that usually are in a position where they work in non-unionized jobs when they do get work, and it's a very temporary work.
Would you close down BC Place?
I would certainly alter it.
Would you close down BC Place?
I would change it.
Jack, if you look what's happening to the downtown east side now, if you see the old decrepit places where people have been living now changed into $250,000 condominiums and people thrown out on the street, and plus the welfare rates are cut down, what's happening? You're having the devastation of a whole
community. The tough thing that Gracie did to you, actually, not Gracie, Human Resources did, was they froze your shelter allowance at certain levels, didn't they?
That's right. Under old policy, you could get a shelter overage. Now you couldn't get an open limit. There was a shelter overage limit, but now for a single person, if your rent is more than $170 a month, you have to take that out of your food money. Now with a $55 cutback, that's going to make it even worse.
Okay, what's the time? 9:20. We may have more on the Brunswick Beach thing. I think I'll do a short segment of calls to Jim Green and Libby Davies. I'm not against them. You annoy the hell out of me at times. You overdo your propaganda, don't you?
No,
we have
don't.
Good targets.
Where have we overdone it?
Who's the brains behind the propaganda? Is it Harry?
Oh, we're all brains.
Is it Harry?
No.
Your guiding light?
No.
Jack, you might look at this as a... We're off camera.
No, take a break. No, we're not off camera.
Oh, sorry.
After the break. Now, somebody went wrong here. If a single mother is classified as an employable and comes off assistance, she keeps her medical for up to a year.
That's correct.
Libby was wrong.
That's Libby was
right.
wrong.
Why were you wrong?
I guess I just got confused.
We all
you got
mistakes.
Carried away with the emotion of the situation.
But the truth is, Jack, if I might interrupt, any single person who's classified from unemployable to employable will lose their medical. They'll lose their dental. They'll lose their pharmacare. They lose all the coverage.
A single parent will continue
That's
on
right.
medical if she's currently getting it.
That's correct.
And I'm told that these new rates are not appealable and that therefore your campaign is a waste of time.
And that's wrong, Jack. And the reason that's wrong is we're not appealing the new regulations. We're appealing the classification from unemployable to employable. That can be appealed, and that's how you stop the people being cut back by $55.
Well,
so we are able to appeal it. It's been shown through human resources. They've accepted our appeals. There's no question whatsoever on that.
Well, my information is otherwise. You'll have to fight that out with the department and let me know what you get in the way of an answer. Because I'm told the new rates are not appealable because they're in the regulations.
We're not appealing the rates. We're appealing the classification.
But the single moms, broadly speaking, will keep their medical cards for
that's
at least
correct.
A year.
Any
my
family
mistake.
With a child.
You're wrong about that.
Yeah, I admit it.
You admit it.
Of course.
I wish Grace McCarthy would admit she was wrong on this policy.
That's a political decision.
That's very correct.
That is a political decision. And if you can elect
Reed
Davy again,
Davy
might change it.
And the reason we should challenge that is that she's saying that the reason she made this decision was to weed out those people who have been on the rolls for months or years and years. But it's very clear, even her deputy minister says in the papers, that it is a political decision. The provincial government has a very difficult cash flow problem. They want to save money. And this group of people, one of the most unpopular groups of people in the province, welfare recipients, they're a very good target. They're good scapegoats. And some people have estimated that they could save $1 million a month. But the thing that I don't think they do realize is that the money that they may save from the cutbacks, they're going to more than make up for all the administrative costs they're going to have added on because of all the extra paperwork of dealing with
especially if your appeal technique is successful.
And just
but
the fact that people will have to be reapplying.
The point I want to make to Noble or McCarthy or DERA or anybody else is that we have a government of Victoria, and it makes a political decision involving money, and it's perfectly entitled to make that decision.
But it's also open to be challenged, and Mrs. McCarthy has said now twice that the school board should not be interfering when they passed a motion. She has lambasted Vancouver City Council for wanting her to send a representative to defend her policy. She's saying, butt out, it's none of your business.
Well, it's none. I saw that piece about the school board. It's none of the school board's business.
They've
got their own business to attend to.
Jack, they have children in the school system who are on welfare, and it certainly does affect how they...
City Council has the same interest. School Board has the same interest.
That's right. They represent the people of Vancouver, and you're interested in it. I'm interested in it. We're all taxpayers. We have a right to.
Are you on the Parks Board or the School Board?
Parks Board.
You can't raise it on the Parks Board.
No, I haven't.
Go ahead to Libby Davies.
Good morning, Jack.
And to Jim Green.
Good morning, Jack.
Yeah, I'm on it.
Good morning. I just finished going to a course at Malaspina College in Nanaimo.
Are you a single able bodied unemployed?
Yeah. Uh-huh. So I went to a course, to better myself.
Right.
Right. I went into the welfare office to ask them for 1 month's assistance while I was going to school to help pay for food.
What did they tell you?
Pardon me?
Are you mad at
us? You know what they told me?
No.
This guy opened a book up and he says, well, according to our policy here, you're not entitled to any money. And I just about died right there on the spot.
How long have you been on welfare?
I've never been. I'm not on welfare. No.
What were you doing before you went to Malaspina?
Pardon me?
Are you going under Canada?
Working on a dredge on the Fraser River.
Have you any money?
I went this course come up. It takes 4 years to get into this bloody course.
Huh? Well, you're not the best example in the world, is he? Because we can't make a judgment on his background, can we?
But it's still the same problem that everyone's facing. Here's a person trying
to
upgrade themselves.
I go there and I ask them for a couple of bucks, see? And they tell me, no, you're not entitled to anything.
So what are you doing now? Did you quit?
People on the street, they drink all their money in the bar. And then they sleep on the street, and they give them money left and right, but they won't give me a working man that's paid my taxes.
How old are you?
29.
How much do you have in the bank?
How much do I have in the bank? Not a goddamn dime.
Well, mind your language and the best of luck. Go ahead, please. I don't mean that to be unkind, but he'll go on forever. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
That's you, ma'am.
Yeah. What I'm calling about, too, is... if Grace McCarthy is cutting back like this, then she's as much as saying that the people that were involved in this, if a person's been on there for years, were not doing their job right, and that these people shouldn't have been on welfare. Well, that's a crock, because if they were on, obviously they went through the qualifications for welfare, whatever it be.
What you're saying is that you have a basic distrust, such as some others have, about the quality of counseling and social welfare. And I'm sure that the department, too, is concerned about the fact, and they're using this as a policy to kind of stimulate a review. Is that not correct?
What she's saying is that the minister is contradicting herself, right? By her own rules, people are meant to be, and I was trying to make this point earlier, people anyway are weeded out, people who are abusing the system, right? Now, what she's saying is that there's a whole bunch of people on the welfare rolls who shouldn't be there. Now, if what she's told us over previous years and what previous ministers have told us is true, then she's really contradicting herself, because the system is already working to deal with those people.
Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes, I get really disgusted when I keep hearing this, always going out and trying to weed out the people on welfare, the people who don't need it, the bad. I think next provincial election, people should seriously think about weeding out some of our bad politicians. And one of them is Grace McCarthy. I'm a working person, and I've always had a job, and I've always had a good career. And it makes me very angry to hear that all our money in government is spent in bureaucracy, always looking
now
to hunting to save a dime and always after people.
Good. Now you're getting somewhere when you talk about bureaucracy. Now, I'd like you to sum up, please, your case now.
Okay. Well.
What you've said... Under the present system of review, which affects single employables, couples with no children, and couples with one or more children, a woman with a... You give me the classification.
Okay. A single parent with one child over 6 months will be reclassified as employable. And if she is reclassified as employable, she will lose $55 a month, and she will have to reapply for assistance every 4 months. DERA is opposed to this policy because we think it's a blanket policy. It doesn't look at people's individual situations or needs. We're trying to fight this policy by helping people appeal any reclassification. We've already gotten Vancouver City Council, the school board, the BC Federation of Labour.
You almost got the City Council, not
No,
quite.
They did. They yeah. passed a motion yesterday. There was only two aldermen opposed to it. They did pass a motion. There's a number
of... Well, you run the council anyway.
No, I'm
You've
not.
You've got Bruce York and you've got Hannah Rankin.
Well, I'm not personally on the council.
You've got Bruce Erickson.
Well, there are only three, but they convinced other members of council to also vote for a resolution that would ask for a public review and scrutiny of the game program.
But the important thing from my point of view is I will not argue in favor of cutting anybody's money on welfare for any reason whatsoever. I can see some logic in what they're doing, however. And you're going to now post your people outside the welfare offices and add to your list of 700 to try and jam the system with appeals.
Jamming the system is something that might happen because the system doesn't work very well because it's very bureaucratic. What we're doing is protecting people from cutbacks by letting them do what they're allowed to do is appeal a decision to the ministry.
Last word for Lily.
Well, we're going to continue appealing and we're going to try and organize public opposition to these welfare cutbacks. We've asked for a meeting with the cabinet in Vancouver and we hope that they will agree to meet with us in Vancouver, and we really want to point out to them very seriously that this is a bad policy that's very punitive.
Fair enough.
To the most vulnerable people in this society.
Because you're so politically colored that your meeting with the cabinet isn't likely to be friendly in any case. I don't blame you for being politically covered.
I don't care whether it's friendly or not, but I just want to make sure that we're able to put our point
the
across
intrepid,
to them.
Intrepid Libby Davies and Jim Green. I wonder if they're listening to all the stuff about BC welfare rates in Goose Bay, Labrador this morning. There is a possibility. Goose Bay. Was there once, froze to death. Back after the break. We now have some videotape footage of the disaster in Lions Bay, Brunswick Beach area this morning. This shows one of the creeks. I suspect it may be M Creek. And there you can see one of the big crane backhoes, which appears to be tugging at a car. There you can see the broken bridge. It was so too, a good 50-foot drop, probably more. It went off at an angle and went through. And that was swept out without a moment's notice, just after 12:30 this morning, and at least three cars. There is a house which was, I believe, on the low side of the creek, and obviously there's furniture in it, and it's been just swept right down off its site. We're in the Horizon helicopter with Steve Wright, John McKeon, the cameraman, Steve Wright, the pilot, and you're hovering over the creek, and it doesn't look that dangerous now, but you can imagine how it was during the night when it was high enough and strong enough and filled with enough rock slide to push right through the bridge and bring down as clean as a whistle, obviously a span of about 25 or 30 feet, maybe more. There is a car upside down, covered with mud, of which they're now trying to turn it over. They got the track equipment in. As the BC Railman said this morning, if the railroad bridge eventually is clear, they can bring in more heavy equipment to continue the search. Another shot of the house itself. I don't believe, we haven't any word on it yet really, but we've had no word that anybody was in the house at the time. It's obviously a house that's been full of furniture and been swept right down, not out to sea, but into the water. And that must be M Creek, which is going there right now. My thanks to Steve Wright and the BCTV news crews for that very fast coverage of this disaster in which six people are believed to have died. I believe now that five bodies in all have been recovered. Five people have survived, one in Squamish, one in Lionsgate, and three treated and released. And you had reporter Brian Coxford telling us this morning about the nightmare experiences of the man who was in the car, which was swept over inside, covered with mud all the way, and the Lord knows how he or anybody got out of that particular disaster. We'll continue with this coverage as we go. Now, I'm going to come to my next guest, who is Rolf Hougen of from Whitehorse, a television mogul and a radio mogul and television mogul in Whitehorse, with whom I am now associated, you might say, at least in visual form, on the Cancom satellite. Now, Rolf, I always get mixed up between Anik B's and Cancoms, right? Perhaps you could give me a little elementary lecture in light of the fact that at the end of the last segment I said, somebody may be watching in Goose Bay, Labrador.
That's
from
true.
Where can they see Webster in Goose Bay, Labrador?
I had a call last week from a gentleman in Goose Bay who said, I receive the signal well, BCTV and the other signals we deliver. He said, BCTV is one of our favorite stations. He also said, I really like Webster.
Now, this, of course, is the explosion. Anik B is one satellite on which we are carried to the north and to your country and the rest of it, right?
Anik B is a satellite that is delivering the 1412 gigahertz, which is a different type of service than we have. It's regional.
Right. Now there is Cancom, right?
Well, the Anik that Cancom uses, Canadian Satellite Communications, is Anik A. And it is a satellite that delivers, well, let us take, for example, BCTV. It is uplinked or transmitted to the satellite.
Right.
That is in stationary orbit, 22,600 miles above the equator. When that signal is received on Anik A, it is retransmitted in a very broad beam. So it can be seen from Newfoundland to Vancouver Island to the high north, as far south as Texas.
On that signal are three private television stations.
At the present time, three English, and as of about a week from now, one French.
Which of the three English stations?
CHCH Hamilton,
uh-huh.
CITV Edmonton,
uh-huh.
BCTV from Vancouver, and a service will be uplinked from the Ottawa Hull region starting next week.
Is that signal now available purely on a trial basis to anyone who can dial it in, say in Goose Bay?
Yes, anyone who has a TVRO or a dish, a receiving dish, can receive the signal now. No charge at the present time. Our commercial operation gets underway on January 1st next year.
When you have your commercial operation underway, does that mean the signal will have to be scrambled and descrambled?
It will, as soon as equipment is available. On January 1st, it will still be available presently, as it is now, without scrambling, received by anyone. But since they will then be licensed, the CRTC hearings are on right now in Vancouver, and these communities will be licensed, and they will enter into a contract with us to receive the signals.
I see. And so therefore, it's conceivable that in Goose Bay, Labrador, some people will sit down, watch the BCTV News Hour, and the Webster in the morning.
Yes, yes.
Anywhere
of course, let's see, the morning. It'll be 1 in the afternoon there. Are they on that Newfoundland half-hour difference? I'm not sure.
I'm not sure either. I don't know that, I'm ashamed to say. We did a little gimmick when we went on the satellite at first on the Anik B, which I wonder if we can show. We showed you the time span between my voice going up to the satellite and coming back from the satellite. I don't remember if I spoke over it or not. Let's see. No.
Oh, yes, I recall that.
You recall that? That's Webster speaking out of both sides of his mouth at almost the same time.
Oh, fantastic.
It's quite impressive, isn't it?
To the Anik B satellite.
That was me going up to the Anik B satellite, and then with Emmy Rosier, whoever's help it was, we got the parallel picture of me coming back again saying the same words.
Tell me, maybe Goose Bay is listening and would phone us.
That's what I was going to say. If anyone in Goose Bay, Labrador would like to call us, or where else, Corner Brook, Newfoundland?
Yes, I'm not certain if they have, but we had a call Edmondson, New Brunswick, Aklavik, Northwest Territories. Do you pay the charge? Do they
pay? We pay and collect.
Oh, great.
Collect. Well, that's very good indeed. I just hope that they enjoy Webster. I know they'll enjoy the BC TV news. That'll be a great thing for the rest of the country to get the West Coast slant on the news anytime they watch a newscast.
Look, as far as I'm concerned, this whole project will, in some small way, contribute to the unity of the country. Because if people in Eastern Canada can see what is going on from a station in British Columbia, they will understand BC a little better.
They'll understand us a little more, because up to now, and I say this with not with any malice or whatnot, but the attitudes and images of the country have been entirely those conceived in Eastern Canada and spread east and west from Central Canada.
We have no problems receiving everything from Toronto, Ottawa, and Montreal.
Right.
But we have great problems getting west to the east and east, the far east. We hope to have an uplink in Halifax or some other point in the Atlantic provinces soon.
Well, I hope to be part of it. My thanks to Rolf Hougen of Cancom. Oh, Whitehorse. Call letter to your station, please.
My television station, yeah. WHTV Whitehorse.
On WHTV in Whitehorse. I'll be back with an old friend. I've had a few arguments with him in my life, and he may put me down this morning. And his name is, what is his name again? Oh, yes. His Lordship, Angelo Branca, QC. And the author of his book, his autobiography kind of thing, Vincent Moore. After the break. As I've said already this morning, events overtake you when news is breaking on the show, but you must handle the news, especially such a dreadful disaster as we had at 12:30 when the mudslide, the rock slide, washed out that bridge over Emma for Mary Creek between Lionsgate and Brunswick Bay. This just is another helicopter shot we have of a close-up we wanted you to see for the devastation caused by this mudslide. What's quite astonishing is when you look at the creek itself, there's a car which was swept off the bridge, absolutely swept off the bridge in the pouring, blinding rain, and I don't suppose it was more than a few seconds before the bridge itself was washed out. Down would come the logs and the rocks and whatnot, hit the underpinnings of the bridge, and away it went. We'll have more coverage for you later. It kind of changes my mood for my next interview. Good morning, Your Lordship.
Good morning, Jack. No more, Your Lordship.
Well, if you don't know that face, you don't deserve to know it. I've been following Angelo Branca around this town for some 35 years, in a small way, but not nearly as intimately as has Vincent Moore. Think about Vincent, whom I have also known for 1,000 years, who has written a book on the gladiator of the courts, Angelo Branca. What, should we be serious or should we be lighthearted
as
this
you
morning?
Like.
As I like.
I don't know if you can be other than serious, but if you can, let's try.
One of my earliest memories of Angelo Branca is him stomping up and down in the police court, you know, when he was the great defense lawyer. But what part did Angelo play, because I'm getting a little bit thin in the top, in the, was it the Summers trial or the Mulligan probe or both?
Both. Both, Jack.
The Mulligan probe.
In the Mulligan probe, which you'll remember better than most of us, I think the Mulligan probe made Jack Webster famous. Would you agree? Wasn't it your first step into? This is the Tupper Commission. We're talking about the same thing.
Originally Tupper. Okay, I'm going to do some cross examination now. You will tell the truth, witness, won't you?
I'll try to.
The whole truth.
As much as I can.
No.
Your memory will not fail you.
No, it won't.
I've seen you giving some terrible... Remember the time you were cross-examining a man and you said to the man, is it not a fact... You tell a story in the books, man. Is it not a fact that you have a conviction for such and such? And what did he say to you?
Know.
He said to you?
You defended me, and I told him no. If I had defended him, he wouldn't have been convicted.
Is that so? What part did you play in the Mulligan probe?
Well, Mulligan, there was a great number of lawyers up there, as you remember. And I was one of many. I think Tom Norris was in it. and I think Jay Gould was in.
George Murray.
George Murray was in the thing. And it was a long, drawn-out affair, you
55
know.
Days.
50, yeah, something like that. Oops. And I think I defended Snyder and Joe Salona, and I had my share of the fun with it.
Bruce Snyder?
Bruce Snyder. He's dead now, you know.
Joe Salona?
Yeah.
Joe Salona, of course, was a very famous character. Would you like to give me a little bit of his background?
Of Joe Salona's
background? Joe Salona's background.
Oh, Vince wouldn't know that.
Vince not know that?
His background, all I know would be his criminal background. But I wonder, Jack, were you in court the day when they arrested the judge and Joe Salona?
For assault?
For assault, yes.
Yeah. Oh, yes. How do you plead? As a matter of fact, that's one of the great media stories of all time. That was during the Mulligan probe.
Yes.
And there was, correct me if I'm wrong, an altercation with Brian Kent.
That's quite right.
A Vancouver Sun photographer. Right. Was it not a fact?
And your friend Sima, our friend Sima was there.
Was it
she
not?
She testified against me.
Well, and was it not a fact that as you were putting out your hand gently to stop yourself from being blinded by the flash?
I wanted to obscure my face.
The camera hit the ground.
That's right. Hit my hand.
The camera
and then fell to the
that's
ground.
That's right. The camera hit your hand that and fell right. to the ground. Is it not a fact that you were charged with assault?
That's right. No, not assault, with public mischief, doing damage to the camera.
Were you really guilty?
No, of course not. Of course not. I was entitled to protect my privacy.
With a straight left.
Now, as a matter of fact, you've come on to a serious topic. Are you entitled to protect your privacy?
Well, I think I am, and I will. The whole thing about the privacy laws of our country now, they've gone down the drain. The police are given too many powers, and the people who are affected by it cannot examine the powers that they are given and control it in any way, shape, or form. Nobody knows. Nobody. These affidavits that they filed are put away, they're secret. They can't be touched, and nobody knows whether the police are abusing the system or not.
Are you talking about writs of assistance?
No. The applications to for an authority to install hearing devices and things like that.
Is it not a fact, though, that the police sometimes must have some extra legal powers in order to protect the public interest?
There's no question at all about that. But if you do, then the system may easily lead to abuse. Mm-hmm. And I'm afraid that it has led to it.
What I'd like to talk to you about, therefore, on this particular occasion, Angelo Branca, and we should be talking about the book, too, shouldn't we?
Thank you.
Gladiator of the Courts, is the new Charter of Rights. Have you taken any study of the new Charter of Rights?
It's not too dissimilar to the Diefenbaker Charter of Rights, Jack.
Is it needed in this country?
Well, I tell you one thing. I think that the fundamental human freedoms are so important that they should be inscribed in such a manner that they can never be changed.
Freedom of speech?
Certainly.
That, mind you, has its limitations in any civilized country.
Of course it has. The laws of libel and slander and things of that nature control it.
Contempt of court citations
exactly.
Also control it.
That's right.
So freedom of speech has got to be, in the final analysis, limited to some degree.
That's right. And it is. But why should that not be inscribed as a fundamental liberty that will never be eradicated from our society?
Can't we trust our common law and the criminal court to protect us?
We have up until now, but I can't see any argument against it. Why shouldn't it be inscribed there?
Well, I'm very much afraid, to be serious for a moment, that if we develop a U.S., and I'm extrapolating a little bit, and if we develop a U.S.-style constitution whereby everything is interpreted by the courts and not changed by the politicians, that we may bog down our entire legal system.
I disagree. I think the courts are the place to give these decisions and not the politicians. If the politicians want to change law as a matter of policy, that is so. But you know in our country, our law courts don't make the law, they interpret the law that is there. And that's their function. They go no further, and they do a good job.
Are you telling me they won't go any further under a Charter of Rights than they presently do under the ordinary statutes?
I don't see how they can. There is a right of free speech protected by the Charter of Rights. correct? Mm-hmm. Somebody wants to attack that, it has to go to the courts. And the courts are going to say whether or not that is an exercise of the right of free speech that is assured, or whether it goes beyond or doesn't.
Now, I can't quote you the specific... Oh, I've got to take a break. Vincent Moore, author of Gladiator of the Courts, Angelo Branca, and the man himself, after the break. Back to the BCTV news coverage of Brunswick Beach again. We have further shots of what's happening there right now at Brunswick Beach, in which six people are believed to have died, five bodies recovered, five escaped. And I think we're going to go in from here to a closer shot of what's happening. That, it must be M Creek. And it is going to, you can see the hole in the bridge right there. You see the line is still across there? One of the reasons it's been difficult to work down on the railway bridge is because the live power lines are apparently still down. And there, that gives you a measure of the depths to which that car was slung over the bridge and covered by the mud that was coming down at the time. Much of it, as the helicopter pilot Steve Wright told us, was of course swept straight out to sea. Dreadful thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Eh? We're back on the air again. I was going to ask, you give some figures in the book, which escaped me for the moment, about the number of murder trials in which Mr. Branca defended and the number who were found guilty. Do you remember offhand?
I think the number were 63 defenses of people charged with murder, of whom two were hanged and four others were convicted on reduced charges, manslaughter, and the others were all acquitted. The judge got an acquittal.
And there were seven prosecutions. One was at Prestique and Warbeck trial. They both hung.
Knight Road and Kingsway.
That's right.
Yeah.
You got a good memory, Jack. Yeah.
I was there that day.
Were you?
When the bodies were discovered in the afternoon, Prestique and Warbeck.
That's right.
I remember that case quite well. But you know, that was a great measure of your skill as a defense counsel. And I don't know if I'm serious or not if I say to you.
I was prosecuting there.
Well, you prosecuted Warbeck. They were found guilty. But the number you defended was in the 60s.
Yes, that's right.
And only two of your clients met the final end.
That's right.
So therefore, about 50 murder charges you beat on behalf of your clients.
That's right.
Do you ever wonder how many should have been found guilty?
Yes. And the answer was none. One hung that I don't think should have been found guilty, that was Hayden, during the course of the war. I think that fellow was just crazy drunk. But because there had been a number of murder trials in West Vancouver and here in Vancouver at that time, I think there were six or seven, a perfectly good defense was ruled out, that's all.
Now, at that particular time, though, what you're telling me is that these people deserved to walk away because the Crown had not proven the case.
And in Hayden's case, I don't say he should have walked away altogether. But there should have been a reduced verdict for manslaughter rather than murder. This poor fellow, he hung, as a matter of fact.
I remember one judge, I don't know whether I remember him fondly or not, and his name was Alec Manson. Did you not have a great deal of trouble with Mr. Manson on a number of occasions?
Yes. Yes, I did.
Are you willing to elucidate any further?
Of course.
Why am I so gentle with you?
He was, I don't care. You want to take off the gloves?
No, you were an...
All right with me, Jack.
You were a pride championship boxer at one time.
Anyhow, Alec was the only one of the judges that we've had in my time that ordered me out of court twice. Once was in a rape trial. And one of the girls who was giving evidence had given evidence in the preliminary inquiry, and it was found out at the end, as soon as I cross-examined her, that everything she said had been told to her by the other smaller girl who was with her.
Hearsay.
Yeah. And Murray and Tom Hurley, who were prosecuting at the assize, they realized they shouldn't touch it. But I think Manson realized that maybe the case might be a poor one unless they had that evidence in. So he says, "Now, little girl, we'll start all over again." That's when I got up.
He was keying her, you might say, to give the here's the evidence.
That's right.
So you got up and said.
Yes, I told him that I wanted to make an objection. So he told me to shut up. And I wouldn't do it. I want to record my objection. So he wouldn't let me record the objection, and I stood up, and I wouldn't sit down. So he ordered the sheriff over to take me out. I told him I wouldn't go out. So he ordered the sheriff over to lead me out.
You were arrested?
Yeah.
And they headed toward the cells with you?
That's it.
And later he changed his mind?
Of course.
Angelo Branca, Vincent Moore, Jack Webster. After the break. I'm going to be serious with Angelo Branca for a moment. There was a time when I was very much a hardliner on drugs and wouldn't give an inch on the drug trade not at all. How do you feel now, sir, about the way illicit drugs are handled in this country? Have we gone soft, or are we just going through a phase? Or how would you handle the use of drugs in our community now?
I think our approach towards drugs is entirely wrong. I don't think the drug problem is one for the law courts or one for the police any longer. And I think it was a problem that had gone beyond that stage many years ago. Today, it is a social problem. And society has to take care of the problem. I favor giving all drug users drugs as much as they need or want through a medical man. I think if the profit motive is taken out of the drug traffic, that the drug traffic will disappear. And the tremendous saving that results because of the policing problem, of the drug problem, will no longer be there. It is said that they tried in England. I don't know how they tried. I don't know what degree of success they've had. But that doesn't mean that we can't try it.
But it'd have to be a continental approach, otherwise we'd get every druggie in the world in this corner of North America.
It may well be, but we have immigration laws that take care of these things. And I think these matters can adjust themselves. But what I say is this. As every year goes by, we find there the drug population is increasing. We find that the profit motive is there. And we're getting nowhere, except the jails are filling up. And the moment you send one to jail, you have 10 more.
And there's another aspect,
step into the shoes.
We're building up a vast police bureaucracy, investigative clue bureaucracy, all of them chasing their own tail.
I agree with you.
But nobody's got the guts to do that kind of thing nowadays.
Well, I don't think the police want to try it. Because if they do try it, and it becomes reasonably successful. All these huge bodies of men that they got, that devote their time and their energy to the drug detection, will be out of jobs.
But then again, you've got to look at it, and you're a very moralistic person, aren't you?
Well.
Yes, you are. You've got to look at it from the point of view of public policy. If you did say, okay, drugs, medically, coke, whatever it is, heroin, how do you stop the downward spread of an easily available euphoria?
Well, I know, but I think these things will adjust themselves. The people who need it now have to get rid of it, have to sell it in order to get the money to buy the drugs for themselves. So they have to have a market for the sale of the drugs. They can't go to the ordinary market because there are too many people selling there. So they go into the schools. I shocked to hear the other day somebody who come from Italy that says in that country, where the control of the family over the children is has been something in past years, that this has all disappeared. And in the small villages, drugs are quite common in the schools. This is shocking.
Next topic. It's one I can I wrestle with many a time, and again, I'm moralistic on it, and I don't know what the answer is. I get offended when I walk down or drive down Georgia Street, and I see all these unfortunate women queued up at the corners, and I've driven down Davies Street and seen the disaster which is there. Now, you're a judge of great experience in handling these kind of things at all levels in the court. What would you do? Should we just tolerate it? Is this freedom of the individual? Should we open red light brothels?
Well, I think that that would give more control. You see, this is the oldest profession in the world, we are told. It has been there. I remember when I started out at law 55 years ago. We used to see these girls in the hallway lining up in the morning that had been arrested for prostitution. It was prevalent then. It has been prevalent throughout the whole 55 years. It is prevalent now. I think it is something that society can't get rid of. It as long as a man is a man and a woman is a woman, we're not going to be able to get rid of that problem. So the whole thing then is to tolerate it as best you can so that it doesn't become a public nuisance, it doesn't offend the public and things like that. Maybe a red light district may be the answer, I don't know.
But surely you'd at least change the criminal code so we don't get some of the, if I may be forgiven, ludicrous decisions whereby a prostitute is chasing a man down the streets and because he didn't say no loud enough, an acquittal is given. Yep. He just said no, no, no. I mean, that's nonsense, isn't it?
This is one of the decisions in law that is really splitting hairs.
I mean, and soliciting is soliciting.
Decisions of that nature, you know, bring the law into disrepute, really.
I would never dare say such a thing. I'm glad
well,
you
I
did.
Say it. I say it.
I sometimes wonder what we do with all these judges, don't you, Vincent?
Well, some of them are so terribly discreet these days. I emphasize these days.
I am not touching that topic with a barge pole this morning.
By the way, what would you do with those girls?
I'd bring back simple soliciting, arrest them, charge them, medically examine them, and have a form of control which could clean the streets of the pest.
Control is a thing.
Form of control. Many girls die now because their friends on the morality squad can no longer keep an eye on them.
That's right.
You know, there's a girl thrown out the Georgia, window of the Georgia Hotel not so long ago, whom the morality squad would normally have arrested the guy and arrested her and stopped it before the killing happened. Where is Mount Sicker?
Mount Sicker's on Vancouver Island, about, 50 kilometers north of Victoria.
What's it famous for?
It's at this moment a ghost town, but at the turn of the century or a little after that, it was famous as the birthplace of Angelo Branca.
You turned Mount Sicker into a ghost town.
Yeah, when I left.
What was it?
Yeah. It was a ghost
town. It was a mining town. Somebody stumbled over a copper deposit and it became an enormously productive one, and then it disappeared in 4, 5, or 6 years.
As a retired Court of Appeal judge, right? Can you appear in court now?
No, but I'm going to make an application to the benches to see if I can. I miss the drama of the courts.
You mean back in police court?
Oh, I'm police court, Supreme County
Court. Supreme Court?
I wouldn't go to the Court of Appeal because that's
that was your
I
own
said.
Court.
That's right. But in the other courts, I think I should be permitted
Have
to
you
go.
Made the application yet?
No, I shall be making it shortly.
You're going to make an application so that you can be back in practice.
That's right.
At all levels of the court, save and except the Court of Appeal, British Columbia. Just can't get it out of your blood, can you?
No, it's a tight. That's where I excelled in my practice of the law in the law court. That's the real romance of the lawyer's life. I'd like to be back there.
How old are you now, sir?
Oh, pretty close to 80.
How close to 80?
A year.
A year, you're 79.
That's right.
Well, when this court asks you a question, will you kind of give a specific
no,
answer?
No, I like to be circuitous.
Yeah.
You know, D.A. McDonald said to Claude McAlpin in the Court of Appeal, Vince tells about the incident. He tried to get a response three or four times and Claude wouldn't give it. Said, Mr. McAlpin, will you play a tune or get off the piano stool?
And to cap you from your own book, a judge, I forget who it was, said, I won't let the jury hear that or you will confuse the jury. And Alfie Bull said, jury, my lord, you're not going to take away our last line of defense, that of confusing the jury.
That was in the Summers trial.
Yeah. And that was in the book.
Yeah.
Gladiator of the court. Vince Moore, Angelo Branca, Webster, back after the break. Thank you. Kind of difficult to set a mood for these mix and match programs this morning. We didn't, of course, know, but had to cover, as NewsHour will continue to cover, the disaster at Brunswick Beach Lions Bay. And earlier this morning, you had Rolf Hougen of Cancom. And on the telephone here, who is speaking? Hello.
Hello.
Where are you speaking from?
I can barely hear you. I'm speaking from Goose Bay.
Okay, can you hear me better now?
Yes, I can.
Good. Steve, Goose Bay, Labrador.
I've got to get away from the television, so I can't watch it on TV because it's delayed here a few seconds.
Well, let me tell the people in Goose Bay that there's a seven-second delay. In other words, we record it here and then we broadcast it 7 seconds later so that if I make a slip of the tongue and say something nasty, I can kill it. So therefore, if you're calling me from anywhere in the country, you've got to turn down your television set or you get instant mental breakdown. Now, you can hear me now, Steve, can you?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
What kind of reception do you get from Cancom and Goose Bay?
It's a little bit fuzzy, but it's very clear. You can see it. I'm from Vancouver. I don't know if you know that or not. I've been on tour. I'm entertaining across Canada. And I used to watch your program every morning when I lived in Vancouver, so I was somewhat surprised when I got up this afternoon and tuned in the local television and found your program on.
Steve, have we met before?
No, we've never met, no.
What kind of entertaining do you do?
I'm a hypnotist.
The name is familiar. Do you think you could hypnotize me into a permanent good mood? Steve,
I think you're probably a pretty good hypnotist yourself.
No, not really. Steve, what are you doing in Goose Bay?
I'm doing some shows at one of the local nightclubs here in Goose Bay.
Well, I'll tell you what I want you to do this afternoon. I want you to get a sandwich board, put it over your head, and hypnotize your audiences to watch Webster on Cancom. What's the time with you now in Goose Bay?
It's, let's see, it's 2:25.
Well, it's actually about 2:18. So you're many hours ahead, 4 hours, 4 hours.
4 hours difference, yeah.
So get the right times on your sandwich board and march around Goose Bay. What's the temperature today?
I haven't been outside yet. It's nice and sunny out here, but okay. It certainly is cold compared to living in Vancouver.
Steve, thanks for the call, and make sure you tell everybody in Goose Bay to watch Webster.
I sure will.
Thank you very much, Steve. Right, bye. That was good. Now, what have I got on my sleeve to talk about this morning? Well, I'm going to have a free-for-all between now and 10:30, and I hope to have an updated bulletin at the end of the program on precisely what the score is at the moment in the dreadful business at M Creek Bridge, and the incredible speed with which BCTV NewsHour got the helicopter in position to show you exactly what happened. Seems to be an awful thing. I'm going to take a break now, and I'll just go for a free-for-all, whatever you wish. Cogent, pertinent, or otherwise, to Webster, that's my name, after the commercial break. At any morning when I'm taking phone calls, I'd like to get phone calls from any part of the country outside our normal viewing area, which of course is British Columbia, Northwest Territories, and Yukon. But here's a note for John McKeachie. I learned from Rolf Hougen this morning, John, that the Canadian Sports Network, acting on behalf of the NHL, has issued a writ to prevent the broadcast, if they can, of the hockey games on the three stations on CanCom, BCTV, CHCH, Hamilton, and CITV, Edmonton. Now, here's a call related to this morning's disaster. Go ahead, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. I believe you can tell me some more about the disaster and the bridge at Brunswick Beach.
Well, my daughter and her husband live in Squamish, and they went through the highway just about an hour before the tragedy happened. So, of course, I was very upset this morning.
Did they happen to tell you if there was any sign of debris or the bridge shaking? No,
there isn't. You see, that's another thing. Apparently some of the cars couldn't stop in time after the tragedy had happened.
Yeah,
but you know what gets me, Mr. Webster, is the fact that those three bridges have been there. There's three old wooden bridges left on the highway, you know, from the year one when the highway was built.
I didn't know if that bridge at M Creek was wooden or not. I forgot to ask that question.
Yes. If you look at those pictures you showed, you know, the underpinnings are running right down by the creek. And what gets me is that the last time they repaired a bridge on that highway is when the one went out south of Lions Bay. And they have not done one thing on the bridges since then. And there's these three old wooden structures that, you know, every time you go over them, of course, we travel back and forth as well, my husband and I. And my daughter was down last night to go to university and to teach at Cap College, and my husband and her husband works in West Van. And they're traveling all the time, and it's like playing Russian roulette.
You're telling me that there are some old wooden bridges on that highway which...
You know, two more, and one of them's over another bad creek. There's two off out of Lions Bay that are over very serious creeks.
Are you speaking from Squamish or this side of the break?
Pardon?
Where are you speaking from?
I'm speaking from North Vancouver.
From North Vancouver.
And I'm telling you, it was very interesting this morning. I phoned the highways department, I phoned the premier's office, I phoned Alan Williams' office, and I phoned Davy Barrett's office, and Davy Barrett's office phoned me back. Because I'm concerned, they've been playing Russian roulette with people's lives with those old bridges for years, and they have been doing nothing about replacing them with, you know, if the span had, if the structure had spanned the gap.
Oh, yeah.
Then, maybe the approaches to the bridge could be washed away or broken.
Just a minute. Yes, we've got the bridge up now, and you can see that it appears to be a wooden bridge in any case.
An old trestle-type bridge, you see. Well, if they had a concrete span or a steel beam concrete span that spanned that, your tragedy would not have happened.
Ma'am, that's a point that's well worth looking into, and I've no doubt that your fears are perhaps valid on the fact that there are a couple of other wooden trestle bridges, but it's quite obvious no one suspected.
There are two more. They've been upgrading, and then on the last slide that went through there, my daughter was the second car behind it.
And just missed it. Thank you very much for your call, ma'am.
Another thing, Mr. Webbs, you may not be aware of, but there's talk of an alternate road through the Capilano watershed, which would be a much safer route, and they're saying that it's 10 years down the line.
Well, the Capilano watershed, the watershed has always fought absolutely solidly against what they regard as pollution, but the day may come when a properly protected road will be the only way. From Victoria, go ahead, please. Hello. Garney, two. From Prince George, go ahead, please.
Hello, Mr. Webster.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to talk about a new act. I'd like to talk about the new act that was passed on June 29th, 81. It's called the Civil Rights Protection Act. And what it does, if you think you're being discriminated against in this province, you can get the help of the British Columbia government to prosecute any groups or persons that think that you are persecuting you.
That's right. You can launch a prosecution on discrimination, providing It was the intent of the person against whom you're complaining, providing it was their intent to affect your civil rights. It's a very clumsy act in which I don't have a hell of a lot of faith.
And not only that, the BC government is going to put out money to help people prosecute other people.
Well, we do that all the time under the criminal acts and the provincial statutes, you know.
Well,
what's really getting under your saddle? What's the real problem that you have?
Well, the problem is, I think, you're going to get a lot of people with a lot of grudges against other people that are going to get financial help to haul people into court, and the people that want to prosecute are going to have an edge over the people that want to defend themselves, because the people that want to defend themselves are going to have to use their own money. The people that want to prosecute are going to be getting financial help.
Yeah, but you and I have got to realize that times have changed, and the ombudsman is a man whom some people think is a busybody, and so is the Human Rights Commission. And each of them has a perfectly valid and proper function in our society, although I think the protection is overdone, to be quite honest. I'll be back after the break.